Welcome my friends to the topic male genital system. So in this topic I am going to cover mainly the three things. One is the pathology of the penis, then most importantly the prostate. We will have a look on the BPH and its complications and what we see under the microscope in the BPH cases. Then the carcinoma of the prostate, very important malignancies in males. Then we will have in the next presentation about the testicular tumors, very interesting topic. So let us have a look on first the penile pathology. So penis is rarely can show malformations, and a few sometimes it may show even the inflammatory disorders. Most important neoplasm is the squamous cell carcinoma of the penis. What malformations are seen? Mainly it is the epispadiasis, that is urethra opens on the dorsal aspect of the penis, so it may be patient may not be comfortable with this particular entity and it may need a surgical correction sometimes. And hypospadiasis, where the when urethral opening will be there on the ventral aspect of the penis. So both these epispadiasis and hypospadiasis can increase the risk of urinary tract infections. Sometimes they can have association with the undescended testis. Non-specific balanitis is very common. Again, inflamed glands penis will be there, or in sometimes inflamed foreskin can be get inflamed. So most important reason for this is the poor hygiene, as well as this magma, that one is the one which is said to be even carcinogenic, that in accumulate beneath the skin of the beneath the foreskin of the glands penis, and it can result even in the intense inflammation, and sometimes inflammation will heal with the fibrosis. So results in the, what are the complications? So it can result in the phimosis, and patient cannot retract foreskin of the glands penis. So other things can, like paraphimosis can occur, retracted foreskin cannot be drawn over the glands. So these are the surgical complications which need to be treated with a surgical excision of the involved skin. What are the infections? So we learn these things again in detail in the microbiology. As such, syphilis is the one which was very common in the olden days, but rarely we come across these cases nowadays. The causative agent is the spirochete, what we call it as Treponema pallidum. And it causes primary syphilis, which will manifest with the formation of ulcers, what we call it as chancre. In secondary syphilis, we will see the formation of the condyloma lata. So remember, condyloma latum is different from condyloma accumulatum. Condyloma accumulatum is caused by human papilloma virus. So that's the point you have to remember. Chancroid is the one which is caused by Haemophilus ducreyi. It's a painful condition, less indurated ulcerative lesion, and patient will have classically the enlarged group of inguinal lymph nodes, and you have to again treat with the antibiotic drugs. Granuloma inguinale is caused by Chylomatobacterium granulomatis. So it is known for formation of the granulomas as such. What is the very characteristic finding is the donor antibodies. So that's the one what you have to see under microscope. Lymphogranuloma venarum, again it forms the granulomas, and it is caused by Chlamydia trachomatis, and penis will show the ulcers and even inguinal lymphadenitis. So sometimes there can be overlapping features between lymphogranuloma venarum and granuloma inguinale. It is a microscopically one should prove what could be the lesion. And this is very common, condyloma accumulatum, human papillomavirus, especially the low risk category, or the one which will cause the warts, what we generally call it as condyloma accumulatum, is called as genital warts. And high risk categories are the one which will cause the carcinoma of the penis. We have three carcinomas in situ. That means if you don't treat these in situ lesions, they can progress to invasive squamous cell carcinomas. So erythropoiesis of the quad, which is the one which is highly precancerous condition, Bowen's disease and bovinoid papillosis. So these three things are the one which are said to be the pre-neoplastic conditions for the invasive squamous cell carcinoma of the penis. The risk factor for invasive squamous cell carcinoma of the penis are again poor hygiene. That's why lack of circumcision in population who will undergo circumcision, they will have a lesser and lesser incidence of this squamous cell carcinoma as compared to the population who will not undergo circumcision as such. Phimosis again will predispose for invasive squamous cell carcinoma. Mainly it's because of the accumulation of the smegma, which is said to be the carcinogenic material as such. So there is a risk of high risk of squamous cell carcinoma penis in cigarette smokers, most important is the human papilloma virus. So sometimes it can be transmitted as a sexually transmitted disease. Classically, the gross appearance of the squamous cell carcinoma will have this finding cauliflower like growth, right? So this is a cauliflower like growth. Ulcero proliferative growth will be there over the glans penis. So that's a most common sight. So what is most important from a prognostic point of view is the how much invasion is there in the different portions of the penis as such. So if it is very much limited to glans penis, they will do the partial penectomy like this. If it is involving the shaft of the penis, then they will do the total amputation of the penis. Along with that, they will sometimes do even bilateral archidectomy also. They remove the both the sided testes. So invasive squamous cell carcinoma of the penis usually arises on the glands or over the foreskin. Prognostic factors are tumor size, the site of the tumor, the growth pattern. Verrucous carcinomas are well differentiated carcinomas and they will have a better prognosis than the poorly differentiated squamous cell carcinomas. That's the one which is grading is one important. More important is the depth of invasion and stage of a disease. Stage of a disease, you have to also look for the metastasis. Is the regional group of lymph nodes are inward or not inward? So any patient with a squamous cell carcinoma of the penis, one has to thoroughly investigate for inguinal lymphadenopathy. They are the one which are first inward. Later on, even other group of lymph nodes can also be get inward. Verrucous carcinoma is what? This is highly differentiated or very well differentiated squamous cell carcinoma. Here also patient will develop with a bulky exophytic tumor and it will have a broad base pushing type of growth pattern. Much of the time there will not be any cytological ERTPR. So plenty of formation of epithelial pearls, what we call keratin pearls, are be seen in the verrucous carcinomas. It also tend to recur, but it will not metastasize. So among the squamous cell carcinoma, verrucous carcinoma is the one which will have a better prognosis. Squamous cell carcinoma of the scrotum was, first time it was explained in the carcinogenesis, chemical carcinogenesis. Percival Pott, he is the one who demonstrated that chimney sweep workers, if they take a daily bath after their work, they are much more prevented from development of this squamous cell carcinoma of the scrotum. So this simple, his public hygiene, he has given that particular advice, take a bath after your work. So that has reduced the squamous cell carcinoma of the scrotum to the great extent. So remember, this is the tumor, squamous cell carcinoma of the scrotum is a tumor which has been taken as a first example for the chemical carcinogenesis, and this is the first time cancer linked to the occupation as such. So with that, we'll have a look on the prostatic pathology as such. BPH, what the surgeon will call as benign prostatic hyperplasia. Is it hyperplasia or hypertrophy? Both. There will be hyperplasia will be there as well as hypertrophy will be there, but hypertrophy is the one which is surgically correct. In pathologically, we will see the hyperplasia of the ductal, the glandular elements of the prostate gland. So we call it as adenoleomyomatous hyperplasia. Adeno means the glandular component will be hyperplasia. Leomyomatous, that means leomyoma like features will be there. That is hyperplasia of the smooth muscle component will be there in the microscopical examination. So adenoleomyomatous hyperplasia of the prostate is a pathological term, whereas most commonly clinician will call it as benign prostatic hypertrophy. Common non-neoplastic lesion, remember here the word non-neoplastic, that means remember the point that BPH remains as a BPH in almost most of the cases. So when we use the word carcinoma of the prostate, adenocarcinoma of the prostate, most of the time it is de novo. That means it will not be followed by BPH. So this particular point you have to keep it in mind. Very, very, very rare that BPH can develop a small foci of adenocarcinomas. Most of the time, adenocarcinomas will not be preceded by BPH. That's an important point. BPH involves the periurethral zone, and as years advances, most of the men will get the BPH. So you see that as years advances, 75% of the men with the age of 70 to 80 years will have a BPH. So it's whether to call it as physiological or a pathological. So if 80-year-old man is having BPH, it is a physiological. If 40-year-old man is having a BPH, then it is a pathological, right? So as the age advances, the BPH is so common. If you live for 100 years, 100% sure that you are going to develop a BPH. Over 90% of the people aged over 90 years, they will have a benign prostatic hypertrophy. It is very, very rare before the age of 40 years. So anybody who develops a BPH before the 40 years, so one has to be careful about these patients. What is the mechanism? It is all due to the hormonal imbalance with the aging. There will be accumulation of dihydrotestosterone in the prostate, and it is the one which is having growth promoting androgenic effect. So all the effects, it is mainly due to the, remember this hormone, dihydrotestosterone, that is the one which is growth promoting androgenic effect will be there for this particular hormone, and that is the one which is causes the BPH. And there are estrogen sensitive periurethral glands will be there, and drugs which will inhibit this dihydrotestosterone and diminishes the prostatic enlargement are the finasteride. So this is medical line of drug which can be used sometimes to treat the BPH. What we will see pathologist, most of the time what we are getting nowadays is the TURP specimen, that is transurethral resection of the prostatic gland. So initially we used to get the entire prostatic gland, so surgical resection of the prostatectomy specimens we used to get initially, but nowadays we are getting only the TURP specimens, that is transurethral resection of the prostate, that will comes in piece by piece. So weight of the normal prostate is around 20 to 30 grams, whereas in BPH it goes as high as around 50 to 100 grams. Microscopically what we see is the nodules of glands at the intervening stroma. Glands will be of variable size, larger glands will have a more papillary infolding. So these papillary infoldings are nothing but hyperplasia of the glandular component. So you should not confuse it for any papillary carcinoma of the adenocarcinoma with the papillary features. So we should not confuse for that. What is the name, pathology name for the BPH? So this is one which is again most important. We will keep on asking in MCQs. Adenoleomyomatous hyperplasia. There will be hyperplasia of the glandular component. Along with that, there will be a stromal component shows hyperplasia. So stromal component in the sense, smooth muscle hyperplasia will be there. So you will see plenty of glands at one area. Along with that, you will also see the smooth muscle hyperplasia. So along with the this adenoleomyomatous hyperplasia, very commonly we also see the formation of the congruence of the prostatic secretions, what we call it as corpora amylaceae. So that's again microscopically we will see the pink homogeneous round congruence, we call it as corpora amylaceae. So surrounding stroma can show inflammatory cell infiltrate. Chronic prostatitis is very, very common entity with the BPH. So we will see very interesting findings in the microscopy. There will be hyperplasia of the stromal component and glandular component, corpora amylaceae and the chronic prostatitis component. And within the glands, we will see the papillary infoldings, but the nuclei will not show any features of anaplasia, and it is the benign papillary infoldings, benign papillary projections. Remember the most important point, nodular hyperplasia is not a precursor of the prostatic adenocarcinoma. So this is the one which is again important from MCQ point of view. See the classical case of BPH, the prostatic gland is very much hypertrophied, right? So here there is hypertrophy as well as hyperplasia, hypertrophy as well as hyperplasia. So here you see this is prostatic urethra totally get compressed. So this is prostatic urethra and this is the right lobe and left lobe. So what you will see is the nodular configuration. Nodular configuration of the prostatic glands with some tiny cystic spaces, and they may contain prostatic secretions inside. So the nodules are separated by fibrocollagenous septus. What we see under microscope, we will see the hyperplasia of the glandular component as well as the stromal component. So these are the glandular areas where you see benign papillary infolding. So papillary projections are protruding into the lumen of the prostatic gland. So one should not confuse it for the papillary adenocarcinoma. It is common finding in the BPH. So don't confuse it for papillary adenocarcinoma. It is the benign papillary infoldings. They have no features of anaplasia as such. There is no any prominent nucleoli to call it as adenocarcinomas. So see the glands, more of irregular glands, variable sized glands, and there is some amount of prostatitis will be there in the stroma. Let us have a look on the what are the complications of the BPH as such. Let's have a look at this diagram. Because the prostatic gland has undergone hyperplasia and it is compressing the urethral tract as such. So urethral compression leads to the accumulation of the urine in the urinary bladder. So urinary retention can occur, more and more urinary retention can occur. So patient can develop even cystitis. And as the workload increases for the bladder, bladder will try to push it at every time, patient has to exert a lot of effort to empty his urinary bladder. So he keeps on putting more and more pressure that can even lead to the outpushing of the wall of the urinary bladder. So patient can develop a diverticulum. There can be hypertrophy of the even the muscular component of the urinary bladder. Patient can have very much a well marked trabeculations can develop in the urinary bladder. So cystitis is very very common due to the retention of urine. This urinary retention predisposes for the urinary tract infection, because residual urine act like a culture media for the growth of the bacteria. So that's how patient will develop a retention of urine. Cystitis is very common. So sometimes, so there can be even development of the bilateral hydroureter and even bilateral hydronephrosis. So in men, whenever you see bilateral hydronephrosis and bilateral hydroureter, one should always suspect about the prostatic carcinomas. So because the back pressure will be exerted over the ureters and even to the kidney. So once you cure this prostatic hypertrophy, so other things will disappear automatically. So these are the complications of the BPH. So urethral compression can occur. Ball wall mechanism is the one where urethral opening in the urinary bladder, that can show ball wall mechanism. Bladder hypertrophy, the muscle of the urinary bladder can undergo hypertrophy. Trabeculations can develop, diverticula can develop, hydroureter and bilateral hydronephrosis. So remember the complications of the BPH. The most common malignancy again in men is the adenocarcinoma of the prostate. Of course, second most common malignancy, first is the lung tumors, lung carcinomas, followed by carcinoma of the prostate. So it is rare, very rare before the age of 50 years, but it becomes more common as the age advances. It is seen over half of the men in 80 years old. So that indicates that as the age advances itself, there is a chance that patient can develop a adenocarcinoma of the prostate. Many of these carcinomas are small and remains clinically insignificant, and you may not come to know that patient is having a adenocarcinoma of the prostate. It is only second to the lung carcinomas, that you should remember, as the tumor related deaths among the males. How to diagnose the adenocarcinoma of the prostate? So most important, again, per rectal examination. So that's the one which is very important, physical examination you have to do. You will feel that the prostatic gland is hard, gritty, and fixed nodule is there. Nowadays we have a transrectal ultrasound examination which will prove that yes, patient is having definitely the prostatic adenocarcinomas. We have a tumor marker studies. It is not only useful for diagnosis, most importantly it is useful for the follow-up of the patient. So that means once you resect the tumor, PSA levels will come down, almost reaches the normal levels, so or even to the zero levels. But after follow-up, say 4 years, five years, if the patient is again having a raising levels of PSA levels, then you should think that patient might be having the metastatic deposits somewhere, and they are growing and they are producing the PSA level. So it is known for recurrence of a tumor as such. Nowadays we are getting TURP specimens, that is transurethral resection of prostate. So it is both the therapeutic as well as diagnostic. None of these methods can really detect the small cancers. So small cancers you can miss. They may be very tiny and they may not be much problematic to the patient. So if at all you do autopsy cases, you may see much more incidence of the adenocarcinoma of the prostate. Occult cancers are more common than the clinically significant carcinomas. So prognosis of the adenocarcinomas, so it all depends on the grade. We call it as Gleason's grading of the prostatic adenocarcinoma. So remember the name, Gleason grading is for which tumor? So it is for the prostatic adenocarcinomas. So in this Gleason's grading, we will see well-formed glands, so he will name it as grade 1. So glands which are cribriform, again it will become grade 3, and which are totally anaplastic with a hyperchromatic nucleus, very very prominent nucleoli, so it is grade 5. So you have to look for the different areas. So we will see where is the worst grading. So we will club two areas, then we will finally put a additional grading. That is a Gleason grading. So that is the one which will actually indicates the prognosis of a disease. Higher the grade, more will be the worst prognosis. The prostatic adenocarcinoma can cause the urinary tract obstruction, and metastasis is very important. It is through the bones, and it is most of the time it is the osteoblastic metastasis that will take place. Osteoblastic metastasis will be there very importantly for the adenocarcinoma of the prostate. And once there is a bone metastasis, there will be increased levels of the alkaline phosphatase levels, and bladder can be get distorted because of the adenocarcinomas. Kidneys can be get damaged later on. Patient can also manifest with the hematuria. remember spread to the lungs and liver is quite rare, but spread to the bones is most important. So you have to look for the vertebral bones, you have to look for the bones as such. The bony metastasis is very, very important for the prostatic adenocarcinoma.